that right?
I'm gonna do my goodness. That's a first.
Exactly. How's that? Excellent. First thing I want to do is make a very, very, I can't stand these things in my hand. That's why I never use them. Very general announcement. Would everyone please turn their mobile phones off? It's something that ought to be obvious at this point, but nevertheless, it isn't always. So please turn your mobile phone off. It'll give me a chance to introduce Paul Nakazawa, who is going to talk a lecture titled The Sorcerers Shrink, which might be as what would I say? I guess I didn't know what it meant possibly as much as all of you, or many of you in any case. And I sat down for a couple hours with Paul this afternoon to find out what exactly the Sorcerer's Shrink might be. And I said, Paul, what is it that exactly that you do, and how did you get to what you do? And he said, I'm not about to tell you either of those things, because that's actually the subject of my entire lecture. So I'm still somewhat in the dark, which is an enjoyable dark to be in, but I can tell you a little bit about Paul by way of introduction. I heard someone come up to Paul and say, rather than the Sorcerer's Shrink, in fact, it would be the Sorcerer's Financial Advisor, which I thought was another enjoyable way of describing him, because we've talked about a lot about money and a lot about practice this afternoon. Paul lectures at Harvard University about architectural practice. I'm not going to even begin to try to define it, because in a certain way, what I've found from Paul and discovered from Paul is that it's not something nearly as simple or straightforward as I might have ever hoped or imagined. And I think what Paul is going to do tonight is probably unravel and unfold quite a lot of different ideas about practice, but most of all, as we were both saying, is it isn't AIA Form 150, nor is it any official RIBA form. Paul acts as a consultant on architectural practice and has acted as a consultant to many of the world's most renowned architectural firms. Two that immediately spring to mind are UN Studio and Snoeta. And at the same time, and Paul, I'm going to give this a try, also to Kyu Sung Woo, who was the 2008 Hoam Laureate Prize winner in Korea. He's a founding member of AMO in New York, which is the branch of AMO, can I say, Paul, that doesn't exist anymore, because Rem moved it to Rotterdam.
It was the original AMO.
That's right, the original AMO. He's going to talk principally about what is practice, but essentially how he got to the point where he is now, and that is as an important consultant to some of the world's most important practices. So, Paul, I'm going to pass right over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for having me here at the AA. It's actually my first time in the building, which is egregious because I've been coming to London since 1963 and somehow never made it through these doors. And particularly to Brett Steele, who extended the invitation. Tonight's lecture is really a first for me in many ways. The thing that I do is not clandestine, but it is a private practice which is engaged in a dialogue with a lot of the world's leading practitioners in architecture and landscape architecture. And what I'd like to do tonight is a form of disclosure about what that practice is, which I have not done publicly before, only because it seems more like advertising than really disclosure. But tonight, it really isn't advertising. It's really about disclosing what it is. In the process, I would like to give you this information in several pieces. First, I will describe what it is that I think I'm doing right now. Then I will go back to the beginning and give you 10 lessons, okay, broken into five each. Five will be about my own gestation, and it's hopefully not an exercise in self-indulgence, but will actually also help you understand where intellectually what I do comes from, because everything comes from somewhere. And I think because this is not the normal thing that you get in these kinds of lectures from other designers, that kind of information may be useful to you. And then I'll look at some of the diagrams that are based upon that gestation. Then I'll go on to another five lessons, not your lessons, my lessons. Actually, the lessons I had to go through. And then go through another series of diagrams that will kind of explain the issues of practice that I deal with. And then hopefully we'll have some time for questions and answers. But in just as a parenthetical note, a lot of misunderstandings exist within the academy about professional practice as it's taught in the academy, only because it's mostly residual. And it's a legal requirement for most schools to keep their accreditation within their countries. And so the discussion around practice in people's minds doesn't really have anything to do with design or anything else relevant, because essentially it is an exercise in fulfilling the statutory requirements or the accreditation requirements of that country. And what I do is not that. I'm dealing with issues of practice, of design, of content development, of actually implementing, you know, the results of this exercise. So that's my area of expertise, not the legalities and the other things that come in most professional practice courses within the academy. So even at Harvard, it is not what I do. So, okay. First five lessons. I'm going to change my glasses here, so I can't see. The lessons in order: awareness, indoctrination, formal education, apprenticeship, and out in the world. How to put to the test what it is that you learned in your gestation. I'm going to take a little bit of time to talk about the origins. I can't actually talk about myself without actually talking about my late father, who was also an architect and was part of the American Bauhaus, and so graduated from the Illinois Institute of Technology, or the Institute of Design, which preceded it, when Mies was there. And family lore has it that before all of the construction site safety rules were in place in the United States, that I'd occasionally accompany my father to the construction site of Cream Hall, which he was a young architect supervising construction of that building. And so my earliest recollections of architecture and the urban environment really comes through two sources. One is Mies, and the other is Burnham, and the city of Chicago, which happily at this moment is the Midwest White House of our new president, so which I'm very happy about. But the history of Burnham and Mies with regard to the city of Chicago, which during the 19th century was in competition with New York as a major U.S. city, gave a very specific kind of ambition, civic ambition, to the founding fathers of contemporary Chicago. And if you really look at the waterfront of Chicago, it is basically intact. The 1906 plan that Burnham made for Chicago, and he was one of America's leading architects at the turn of the 20th century, a businessman as well as an architect, someone who was at home in government as well. So in contrast to Mies, who was not a businessman and not comfortable in governmental circles necessarily, much more an academic. And so the two streams of Burnham and Mies actually in the consciousness of a city that's quite delineated with regard to civic ambition is something that is part of my own heritage as an architect, and where even as an advisor, I always go back to this kind of civic ambition, which is translated into how an architect actually is responsible within the society in which they live, and so is back to what is really your purpose as an architect in the broadest sense of the word, not in the narrower sense that since World War II and the rise of the consumer economy, that, you know, architecture in some ways has devolved into a much more narrow profession. But if you really go back to the 19th century and the birth of a new kind of world based upon the First Industrial Revolution. That is really the inspiration for today, is that we really are remaking our world. The next 25 years of your life will be remaking the world in the same way that the people who came at the after the First Industrial Revolution had to remake their world. And so this kind of greater civic engagement and larger vision for the profession is inherent in the delineation of Chicago as a spatial entity. And where if you go to Mr. Obama, who did a lot of his earlier political work in the city, gives some clues to where he may be coming from in terms of what he will do as president. So that's something that awareness, and for all of you who have that awareness of where you come from, I think it's one of the important ingredients that allows you actually to be in the profession in a certain way. You always go back to see these kind of reference points. The other lesson that I kind of had was being indoctrinated into the culture through the family business. And that, you know, anytime you work in a family business, that can either be a great experience or it can be a terrible experience, or a little of both. And in my own case, my late father was not oppressive as a father, and so I was able to exist within his practice to actually learn the craft of architecture unfettered by a lot of parental pressure. But interestingly enough, the people who trained me in architecture were a number of job captains who actually, in Chicago during that time, there were a lot of high-rise construction. And these job captains would go from office to office in little bands. So there'd be a head job captain, and there'd be a cluster of architects around them, and they would be hired by different offices. And when a high-rise was completed, the pink sheets would go out during the day, and they'd all move to another office. So they'd go from Skidmore offices to Perkins and Will offices and so on and so forth, and they just kind of rotate around the city. And so my own kind of engagement with the craft was these kinds of roving bands of basically craftsmen who would go and actually do these different buildings within the city. The other odd thing about growing up in the business are two things. One was international practice, which during the 70s was emergent, but really not fully blown. And my father had a mania, which he acquired at IIT, which no doubt some of you will acquire here, which is his student thesis stuck with him, and he couldn't get rid of it. So essentially, when he was in practice and had his own firm, he took his student thesis, which was done with Conrad Wachsmann. It was Conrad Wachsmann in the early days of the Bauhaus, and Gropius had this idea they'd do something called the General Panel Corporation with modular housing. And my father took a studio with them and developed his own kind of modular system. So when he got into practice, he took this kind of idea that he had as a student and made a company out of it. and so got into the modular manufacturing business only for interior systems. It was a very expensive system, but you know, comes out. I think half of you will actually have these manias that you carry from school and just can't get it out of your system. So there are a lot of people who come out of school with these things, and then later in life they kind of reappear as ungerminated seeds that just keep, you know, needing to grow. But on the back of that was also there were only two clients that could afford this stuff, which was the United States government and the Saudi Arabian government. And so one day a group of Saudi people came into the office wanting to have a modular system for their new cancer research institute in Riyadh, which at the time was a barren city with an open sewer running through it. And bought the prototype on the site, said load it up in an airplane, and my father went, oh, Paul, you go to install it in Saudi Arabia. So, you know, off I went into the desert, and that was kind of my first idea of international practice, was being sent with a kit of parts into Saudi Arabia for the summer to kind of erect this prototype inside a shell. And so that was kind of another kind of lesson for me. So the family business was actually good. I learned my craft. I had these kinds of formative experiences in terms of being, you know, kind of thrown into the unknown. And I never really thought I'd be an architect, because I was interested in science and physics. And so I went to the University of Chicago as an undergraduate. I pursued physics as an undergraduate. It was during the Vietnam War and also Cambodia. And at some point, I decided that I really wasn't cut out to do theoretical physics, and that perhaps being lost in life, business school would be kind of an intuitive choice, even though in the culture at the time, going to business school was counterintuitive. That was kind of the last place in the world any self-respecting person would sign up for. And so I did that. And in the process, did learn a lot of interesting things. And being a counterintuitive choice was actually good. I did all my electives in music and discovered urban geography. And to the great distress of the dean, who wanted me to take more banking courses, sailed through the school kind of half awake, but doing all sorts of lateral things which would serve me well later. And in my last year of business school, realized that indeed the family genes had taken hold of me, and that I'd need to go to architectural school, even though this didn't seem like the thing I was cut out to do. So I went to the GSD, and the GSD was an interesting place then in the 70s. All the people that you think of in the magazines whose careers are even peaked, like Richard Meyer, were hanging out. Because in the 70s, there was nothing to do. It was after a recession. Basically, the 1974 boom bust in oil left everyone without work. And so you had all these kinds of thinkers and designers hanging out in the GSD because they had nothing else to do. And it was great, you know. So you'd have a whole bunch of American architects who now have very successful firms kind of hanging out in your place, which is... This is the byproduct of a good recession, is that all these people are going to start hanging out, you know, in your neighborhood, because the stress of being in business with nothing to do will drive them all back into the academy, not necessarily to teach, but actually to kind of be with people where there's still hope. Right? So this is it was actually very good. But what I would say in school that's important is not just what you learn, but the relationships that you make with other people that you are sitting next to. So if you guys look around you in your room here, you will find the future. You are looking at the future of the profession. And the profession is so small that that what will happen is that 20 years from now, no matter what you think, 20 years from now, when you're in practice, this kind of environment will essentially form the community of practice, even globally, that you will be part of. And it's a very important thing that you, while you're in school, understand who it is that you're sitting next to, and not just kind of come here and do your thing and then go home or whatever. This is the place where it all happens. So, like many of you, you kind of got ejected from school. No one has really given you any guidance as to, like, what the next step is. And so you're kind of left alone to figure out what it is you're going to do. Fortunately, if you're in school and you're awake, you will find your mentor early. And I did quite by accident, but it was Rafael Vignoli, who at the time was teaching at the GSD. He was at the GSD in 78. And I used to smoke cigars with him in the basement of the faculty club. He wasn't my professor. We just happened to get along, and he was friends with Mario Campi, who was one of my professors. And these informal contacts are interesting. So what happens? A lot of things in life are random, but I liked Vignoli. So when I went to New York after graduation and started working with Ed Barnes's office, which is a different story, I won't bore you with it, I sent him a postcard. Said, look, you know, I'm at working at Ed Barnes's office. If you're ever in New York, I'd love to see you. Pay attention. These things. It arrived at his house the day he was leaving Argentina. So in a couple of weeks later, I got a call at Ed Barnes's office. And I picked the phone up, and he says, you won't believe who this is. I go, Raphael, what are you doing in New York? He says, well, you're the only one who figured out that I was actually moving, so how about lunch? So we met for lunch, and in 2 hours, I had made up my mind that I was going to leave the Barnes office. He had no work, no money, you know, kind of, he had some vague idea what he was going to do in New York. But I knew that Mr. Barnes, the reason I went to the Barnes office was because he had spawned so many architectural offices in the city that for me, it was the environment, not the job, that kind of produced the opportunity for you to learn. So my theory was, if you got a job with someone where there were things happening, people were actually spawning practices out of that practice, it had to be a place where that environment produced the kind of things that you would be interested in as a practitioner. So in every generation, there are two or three offices in these major cities, whether it's New York or London, or that are producing prodigious amounts of practitioners. They take them in, they kind of train you, and then they spit you out. But then a lot of these people kind of subsequently go into practice. So this is a good theory, and my students also practice it, and it's been very beneficial to people who want to pick up the essential ethic of how to practice at a very high level. But starting the Vignoli office was important to me, and would actually be decisive in the sense that he would be my mentor, and I could find a mentor immediately out of school. That where it was new for him, it was also new for me. It was new for him in terms of a country, but he was an accomplished practitioner. It was new for me in terms of practice, but it was my country. And so this kind of deal was an extremely interesting one because we could help each other in very concrete ways. And in 3 years, we had built the kind of core of a practice, but it wasn't incorporated as a firm yet. So I always say I was the first person in his practice. I never worked for his firm. And when you look at that period of time, there was also a lot of back and forth in terms of starting of people like Vignoli talking to other people like Pelli or Pei. We would do a lot of joint venture work. And so the ability to be at a table with other accomplished practitioners very early in life is a very important thing for you to do if you can arrange it. Whether it's engineers or, I mean, anybody who is a good practitioner, who is doing work at a high level, being at the table as a young person and being able to kind of absorb what it is that they're talking about and how they approach problems and everything is something that is invaluable for a young person that starting out in practice. It cuts out, essentially, you can learn 10 years of stuff in 3 years if you do it that way. The other thing is by working hard for 3 years, you can essentially get your 10 years worth of experience doing this by having the proper mentors. All of these things are elements in gestation. Each of you will have perhaps a different way of gestating, but the elements really of awareness, if you're not aware of it, you can't learn it. If you don't have formal education, it's very hard to be self, it's very hard to be just an autodidact, so it gives you a framework. And apprenticeship is important to acquire the kinds of knowledge that will help you acclimate yourself to a practice environment, even if you're in disagreement with it. The final lesson of this was leaving New York and doing something else that was considered horrendous, which is I moved to North Carolina, which in the 1980, which in the 1980s was a sleepy southern town, and my colleagues in New York felt that I had abandoned both them and I'd lost my mind. But I went to North Carolina partly to fulfill a family obligation to my father because he wanted to retire. He thought he would actually build a practice there, which didn't actually turn out to be what he could do. But it taught me some other lessons because in Charlotte, there was a group of bankers who would turn out to be America's most innovative bankers and took a very small regional bank, parlayed it into a large national bank that swallowed Bank of America, which is one of America's largest banks. And so this small group of bankers and financiers actually, right in front of you, Charlotte is a very small city in its core. Within 10 blocks lie all of the decision makers of some of America's largest corporations. And so spatially, these people could actually talk to each other regularly, informally and formally. And so what happened was I abandoned really basically the practice that I was in my family's practice and joined an organization called Triple Harris Lee, which would then be floated on the London Stock Exchange in 1986, just in time for the market crash in 1987. But at that point, the ability to go from, you know, the protected environment of my gestation, which would have suggested that I stay in a certain kind of practice, like Vignoli's practice, you know, something devoted to design and everything, and go to a commercial practice was kind of an interesting shift. But it was here that I actually learned my craft of technically how to deal with practice, because it was a 400-person practice. It was a very complex practice with a lot of different divisions and parts. And by joining this practice during a period where, all, you know, we floated on the London Stock Exchange in 1986. We did an initial public offering then. We raised, I think, $25 million, the equivalent of 20, which at the time was an enormous sum. And we merged our firm with Cavell Matthews Wheatley, which is at the time the UK's fifth largest practice, in mid-1987. In October of 87, the stock market crashed. In the following 5 years, the unemployment in the industry was horrendous. And so what this period was actually quite miserable for me personally, but it allowed me in a privileged way, because I had an MBA and I had an architect's degree, to actually get into every piece of that company and look and examine what the operations were and what was failing in the company. And for those of you who are interested in what might happen at the turn of this recession, because it is coming, and it is even uglier than 1987, that you have to understand, by living through these things, you acquire a certain kind of knowledge as a practitioner, which attitudinally prepares you to let go. We'll talk about this in a minute, but the thing about crashes and about the end of a certain period is every stock market crash and economic recession produces failure of people who used to be successful. And the seeds of change in the architectural profession have always blossomed after the worst recession. But the seeds of change of the architectural profession of the next blooming are already in the ground. And so the people who were successful in the last, up till this last kind of crash, cannot hang on to what it is that they were successful at, because the next round of practice isn't about what it was in the last before this recession. So the bad news is the party's over for people who've already built successful practices on a certain way of thinking about practice and have certain models of practice in their mind. The good news is that there's room for new kinds of practice and a new way of thinking about it, but you'll have to go through the fire in order to get to that new place. And so the thing is that what I learned out of this particular period is hanging on to old ways of thinking about what is success and what is useful in practice and all that is it's all open to question at this point, and you need to rethink what it is that you're doing. And that's why guys like me start hanging out in schools during recessions, because we're looking at you. All right, so enough of my harangue, but I'm going to talk about now kind of what I learned out of this period. I'm kind of going to try to distill it for you. So there are people who want to be artists, designers, thinkers. That's how they see themselves. And then over here you see people who call themselves architects but really are in a business. And then in the middle are people who call themselves professionals. They're not necessarily artists or thinkers, but they are not necessarily either business people. And so what's that about? Well, these people are really not defined by the profession as in terms of the legal mission necessarily of how the law actually defines professional. But they are interested in projects. And why are they interested in projects? Well, because projects can have inherent interest in and of themselves. And so if you have this idea about what you want to do, the only way to do it is with a project, right? It also calls for behavior that's improvisational. And essentially, the mode of acting in the world is a negotiation, actually, between what you want and what a potential client wants. So you're really building a practice around an autonomous agenda. It's your thinking about what it is that you want to do. And then your idea of getting work is that you will essentially either find a patron who's bought into what you want to do, that's one way of doing it, or if it's not a patron, then a client who you will basically negotiate your interest with their interest, and hopefully there's an overlap and everyone's happy. Now, where that overlap doesn't exist, then somebody's not happy, hopefully not the client, because they'll fire you. Then there are people who are professionals who really owe a duty, actually, both legally and ethically, to their clients. And so their response, actually, in terms of what they do, is that they customize their response to what a client is looking for. Now, that doesn't mean you do what the client wants you to do, because that's not actually serving a client. It's actually just caving and just doing what the client says. But you're serving a client's interest. You're not serving a client, right? You're serving their interest, which means that as a professional, you are customizing your response around what their interests are, and you're an advocate for their interests. So you're building a practice around client demands and interests, not necessarily just doing what they say. But I mean, a professional's duty is to stakeholders other than their clients, but it's codified. Here, the mission here is not necessarily codified. This is a codified response, both in law and ethics. On this side and I'm making a cartoon. Understand that this isn't purely correct. This is kind of pushing the envelope for the sake of argument. And then there are businesses, and they're really not defined by the profession either. They're defined by their markets. So their response to a place is specialization, which is they take knowledge, they specialize in something, and they innovate on that knowledge to increase market share. And they build a practice around markets, specializing and versioning actually their response to something. So they're looking for a pool of clients who essentially have common needs, and then they're trying to put an offer into a marketplace. I make this cartoon because it's not strictly true. Actually, in practice, you'll find that everyone needs projects, clients, and markets. But if you really push it in its purest form, the way that the profession kind of is disposed is that there are people who essentially are after opportunities to practice their agenda. There are people who are centered in a relationship, and then there are people who are centered in a market. And that's not necessarily about a relationship, it's about an offer. It's what kind of value do you put into a marketplace. And so practice in each of these modes is distinctly different. It colors what it is that you think about as a practitioner. Now, if you take someone like an Edward Barnes or a Vignoli, they're in the projects category, more or less. Over time, I think there's migration into either markets or clients, but you start from a certain place. My corporate practice was really interested in markets. We were interested in a market share of office parks and stuff. Like both Covell Matthews Wheatley and Tribble Hersley were kind of leaders in their own markets in terms of design of office parks. When the office park market went away, and it never came back again in the same way it was in the 80s, they were extinguished as a practice. Now, if you are an artist or a theoretician, you don't want to drag a big organization around you, right? You prefer small and simple. You don't want 1,000 employees. You want 5. If you're a business, you're eventually in order to put if you're going to be a business, the whole notion of business is augmentation. And so, you can't do that without a large organization. So if you really look at size, these people, even today, have tried to maintain firms under 100 people, because over that number, you can't control an agenda. I defy anyone with 100 people to have an autonomous practice agenda and control it. It's very hard to do it. Over here, it can be in the thousands. So if you talk about how these firms think about income. Let's talk about money for a minute. And if you take a look at the mix of business and the triangles, the area of the triangle is the amount of money you have, so the total area of the triangle is the amount of money. An artist or theoretician wants to fill up their triangle with projects, income from projects, and then anything else that happens to be a relationship is other. Whereas a professional practice, in order to be stable, actually needs some projects, which is the source of innovation or change within, it seeds change within their company. They need clients and markets, which take up a good portion of their business. And for stability, they would like ongoing relationships with clients who will feed them a stream of work. Now, in Europe, this disposition is less common than in America. And so, at least it used to be. So a lot of firms that are in trouble right now are of this sort, which means that if you're after projects, you have to continually market for projects, right? When one project's over, you have to have another project. You don't have a relationship, so no one is just going to hand you the project or go hunting. So these people are hunters. They're not farmers. They can't cultivate a field. These people can cultivate a client. And what's a client? Someone who continually buys services or acquires, who has the need to acquire services. People, practices which are professional practices of most any size empirically, 50% of their business is derived from no more than 6 clients. My experience is that I have firms that are over 1,000 people. 6 clients account for more than half their revenue regularly. And then when you get to the business model, you want to increase the amount of revenue that comes from clients and decrease the amount that comes from other sources. But what does that do? It commits you to building organizations around the needs of others. This does not commit you to building an organization around the needs of others, right? But the trade-off is, if you build an organization around your needs, you suffer the consequence of that, which is when no one needs you, they don't need you. And when the market's slow, the market's slow. So, you know, if you can go hunting, but if there's no buffalo on the plain, you know, you starve. On the other hand, the farther you get into building your own existence around the needs of others, you lose track of your own agenda, and then it's all about them and really not about you. So if you want to have any independence in terms of your own thought processes, it's not that there's no merit to that. There is a need, a great need, in all countries and all places for that model. But it circumscribes your ability as a practitioner to navigate an intellectual agenda of your own making. Right? You don't have as much freedom. So maximum freedom is that way, and more circumscribed ability to act goes that way. But the trade-off is clear. So the other thing that came out of this kind of period of gestation was I kind of figured out what the four elements of what it took to develop a practice was. And in the bad old days, when before globalization, if you lived in a community and you had the capability, you were an architect, they had the local doctor, they had the local lawyer, they had the local architect, they had the local surgeon. You know, if you were capable of doing something and you knew everyone in town, guess what? People gave you work, and if you did a good job, they give you more work. Right? The minute you had to travel with what it was that you did, if you didn't have something that differentiated you from just being able to do it, then you actually couldn't just rely on your capabilities and your social network. But I will tell you that in the world, there are some very large firms that only deal in capabilities and networks. Their ideas and their imageability in a broader sense are non-existent. And there are firms that are hundreds of people actually that exist only on the basis of what they can do and the people they know. If you want to travel outside of your geographic region, the ability to inflate ideas and also be imageable, be memorable in some way, becomes a necessity. And therefore, the exercise of traveling outside your geography is that if you don't have these other areas of differentiation, it's impossible actually to get out of your localized condition. And what globalization has done to practice is that it's constantly caused firms that want to compete in a larger arena to have to develop some sort of intellectual capital in order to do it. But understand, intellectual capital isn't design. You know, for those of you who are pure designers, understand that the stuff on the top isn't about design. And therefore, when you start looking at practice and not what you're doing as students or not what you're interested in doing necessarily, but you look at the firms that you work with or you're trying to make your own firm, this top end is really, you know, intellectual stuff isn't about form necessarily. You can say it is, but that's not what we mean by that in terms of business parlance. So if you can't actually get content, intellectual capital, some sort of idea capital into your hands, it's very hard to understand how to differentiate your value to to others. Now, in the 90s and 80s, a lot of firms were started basically by propaganda, right? They would go to the academy, they'd propagandize ideas. They wouldn't have any capabilities, basically. So they would start the opposite way, right? The profession actually harbors the first two, to be socially responsible, which produces social capital, and to be competent, which is to make your implementation capital. So the profession actually promotes the bottom two, right? But the academy in the 90s actually promoted the top two and not necessarily the bottom two. At least some of the academy that I was in, you know, our students couldn't do anything when they graduated, which meant that we didn't educate them for capabilities. We educated them for something else, and we could produce the top two boxes and not the bottom two boxes. I mean, to be frank, right? So, for a while, our students were great propagandists of ideas and would essentially go out into the world without any capabilities and minimum social networks and would compete in the arena of ideas and basically image making. And in a consumer economy, actually that kind of works okay. And then when they got stuff, then they built practices around it by going like, oh, I want a competition. Like, how am I going to do it? And then they go like, oh, geez, I don't know any engineers. And oh, my God, I don't know how to detail a lobby. And oh, my God, you know. So you can play with this diagram any way you want, but what I'm saying is that you can start anywhere and get to the other box. And in different periods, it's been used different ways. But my father was in the bottom two boxes, and then he figured out how to do ideas. He could never wrap his mind around the image thing. He didn't know how to represent himself, so he was within a very narrow band of his own practice. And you know, Vignoli had a great deal of capabilities when he came to New York from Argentina. His social network was zero, but because he knew how to promote different ideas, he could actually come with intellectual capital, implementation capital, and he knew how to build an image. He didn't have one in America, but he knew how to build it. So he started with ideas and capabilities and built the image and networks behind it. So this is the way this thing works. But if you want to be a practitioner, you have to have all four in a global economy. And I also learned out of my gestation period this diagram, which I would continually make errors in my own professional choices thereafter. And eventually, I learned better. Okay, so you don't have to make these mistakes because I'll explain to you what they are. Look, they're practice as an idea, I mean, as an organization, is pretty simple. There are like only four things you need to know. One is you actually need to be able to have an idea about why you're practicing and be able to articulate and represent it properly. So if this is called enterprise. The enterprise is the vision and purpose and representation of your practice, whatever that is. Right? And every firm has to do that, whether you're doing houses or you're doing kind of university buildings or you're doing kind of global star architect buildings. You have to actually be able to do those things. You also have to be able to produce, right? So the P, which is the production, is like doing work, which is everything from designing it to, you know, the working drawing, whatever part of the value chain that you choose to do. But something, you have to produce something, right? Otherwise no one's going to pay you. And then the other one is I, which is the administration, the infrastructure that's required in order to make E and P work. So in the, and C is really, in large firms, the control piece, which holds the corporation together. So it's the CEO, COO, CFO, CIO, right? Chief Operating Officer, Chief Executive Officer. And in small practices, it's empty. The center is empty in a practice. Why is it empty? Because you can't make progress from the center of anything. Right? The center anchors things. It doesn't move things. So almost all practitioners move their practices from E or P. Either they define their mission and push their practice through the door of mission, or they push their practice through the door of production, which could also be design, which is you produce something, whether it's a product or a service, you push it through the values of producing something. So IM Pay and Partners, when IM was there, was basically a practice pushed by issues of P, which was, they were classic architects being pushed by the value of their design. And someone like OMA was pushed by E. This is the definition of the mission. These overlaps are pure managerial spaces, and I'll explain in the firm of me, myself, and I. Me is an architect that's trying to figure out how to get work. So I go out and I try to find work. Finally, I find someone who'll give me dormer additions to do. So I drag it back to my garage, and I work on it on my table in the garage. I go back out, and I keep doing that. And on weekends, I balance my checkbook. That's how this diagram works, right? So then I do that, and then I go there and do that. And myself, I'm doing administration on weekends. If you start building this up, the first trauma is you get your first employee. So you are here because if you're founding a practice, you have to go out and get the work, bring it back. And you have someone sitting in the garage who didn't go to the meeting and doesn't know what to do. So the first trauma is like, well, what happened and what do I have to do? And the trauma is that now you have to explain to somebody else what to do. And that gives rise to this space, which eventually becomes project management, which is the first trauma of having employees. If you then grow the firm even more and you have, like, say, 5 employees here, then you can no longer balance your checkbook on weekends because you're just too busy. Not only that, you need to collect money and do all sorts of other administrative things, and then suddenly you have to fill out all these forms for the government to have employees, and you have to follow other kind of employment law, and you're overwhelmed. So then, you know, you need a bookkeeper or you need someone else to help you with the administration work. And then you need timesheets, and I mean, the birth of all these other kind of managerial things that are very practical starts consuming you, because as the founder of the firm, there's no one with any authority to actually do any work in these spaces. So you wind up running around this propeller. And at that point, earlier in my career as a management consultant, I get a lot of calls from designers who found themselves what I call in the propeller. This propeller is the zone of all fuck-ups in practice, right? For people who are really competent, there are enough fuck-ups in design and delivery, but the real fuck-up is that you did the wrong thing because no one told you what to do, the right thing to begin with, or that you couldn't communicate with the client what to do. And so, you know, it's really the communication overlaps. And when you really look at either small companies or big companies, which I was in from the time I was in family practice to the time I was on the London Stock Exchange, this diagram always came back to remind me that, you know, there's always this zone of incomplete communication, which haunts the design practitioner, and why we have such a bad reputation in the world as being bad managers is basically we can't manage those overlaps, pure and simple. It's we can manage our work. We're interested in it. We can kind of manage to sell our work. Well, we just can't manage to get our act together to hold all of the domains together. And the thing that I learned at the end of my gestational period in terms of the stock market crash is this. There are periods where if this is the wave. So the bottom thing is time. This is change. This is the y-axis. Over time, there are periods where practices learn things. Then they have another period, which is the second period, where you actually master what it is that you're doing. And finally, you think, I understand, I got it, I'm going to keep doing this, and you find success in it. So you keep propagating this certain behavior, and suddenly you think that you're bulletproof because you're so good at it, and everyone else says you're good at it. Well, that's not the way life works, because at the end of all good things is change. The market changes, there are changes in technology, fashion changes, there are all sorts of change. And at some point, what you do doesn't grow to the sky. And at period three is, some people in the practice think that things will keep growing to the sky, and other people start questioning, why are we keep doing this? Because obviously our days are numbered, right? So there's a period at the end of this inflection point in number three, which is a discussion internal to firms, is like, do we need to change or not? And why? Because the people for the status quo are, we're so good at this, you know, we're recognized, we've got all these awards, you know, we're making money, blah, blah, blah. It's just like, why change? And then there's always some troublemaker in the practice that goes, yeah, but you know, aren't you getting bored of this? Or, you know, I see things changing, and everyone goes, shut up. Right? And in fact, if you don't change at that point or figure out what to do next, the market change, like 87, comes and kind of wipes you out. And you go like this, right? So there is this period of dissonance that had been happening for almost a year. And for those who were alert, they have already changed kind of their direction. And for those who thought that the trees grow to the sky, I have a little bit of a problem on their hands right now. And so when you really look at what happens is that there are people who assume that that's the trajectory, right? That they can keep doing what they've been doing. And then you have a gap in here. This gap is a recession. The recession is that there are no buffalo on the plane. So if you want buffalo for dinner, there ain't any. And so this time gap causes the firm to go into a decline, right? And firms that don't realize that there's something else out there that they need to be searching for that will allow them to grow back do one of these. That's what Triple Harris Lee did. We spent all of our time trying to save our butt rather than looking for the next thing. So we spent all of our energy trying to hang on to the thing we knew rather than to look for the thing we didn't know. And that's the thing about recessions. If you try to reinforce the thing you know, you're headed for that. And the object of a recession is to buy enough time so you don't crash, you just kind of go down, but then you have the chance to recover. That is the secret of a recession. Some journalist talked to me the other day, and I said, well, you know something? You already lost. The people who think that this is just a temporary thing and blah, 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 you already lost it. I mean, just let go. And you have to reinvent now what it is that you think you're doing. And that will give you success. All right, so now we're back to my harangue, but I'll make it short. So after this kind of flame out of 87, which was horrendous, but I learned something, which was a sore lesson. But I made another series of mistakes, which were interesting. In my last year of working at Triple Harris Lee, I was approached by the Softy practice to become the managing principal. Basically, the Softy had come off of what the Canadian papers called a one-man building boom, had come off a number of series of very successful public commissions in Canada, the National Gallery of Canada, he was doing the Ottawa City Hall. I mean, They were all museums galore. So, and the principals were tired of trying to manage the firm. So they spent a couple of years looking for a managing principal. And I'm the lucky guy who got it. And I'm still friends with Moshe, but the assumptions that I made going in were ludicrous. If I had actually paid attention to what I had actually kind of known back then I would have not made that mistake. But I thought I was going to be hired for the center. No, I was hired to do the propeller. The center in a design firm, the center, which is the control point, is only a meeting space. All of the important things that happen in a practice are either an E or an P. So when someone says, you know, congratulations, you're managing principal of OMA or managing principal of SAFTIER, the sorcerer's manager is not in the center. The sorcerer is in the center making magic when they want to, but they're usually making magic in E or P. What the managing principal is doing, which everyone wanders, you know, all of you probably, for those of you who work for firms, you're wondering who this person is in the office that kind of maybe looks like an accountant but really isn't and seems to have authority and just wanders around kind of trying to make decisions. That's the managing principal, right? They're in charge of all the overlaps. They're trying to keep everything glued together in this kind of insane kind of chaos of communication. But there was a lesson in that as well, which is that at some level, when you work for people who have this great ability to do work, imagine work, design, there's an ethical strain in everybody who works at that level. And that is about an integrity about the work that they do. You may agree or disagree with the work that they're doing, but everyone who is a practitioner at that level has a very solid spine of ethic that goes through the kind of work they do, why they do the work. There's a clarity about what it is that they're after in their work. And so it was, a reinforcement after kind of my experience in corporate practice where that really wasn't the case, of reestablishing kind of this understanding and dialogue with somebody who had very clear principles about what it was that they were doing and why. And also, as a practice, was one of the few practices that I know that, without actually being explicitly about history, was rooted very much in the history of place, because their work in Jerusalem and the Old City and stuff is rooted in the history, a very long history and tradition of a place. And that in itself was a very interesting exercise in being not cut off from the root of history. I mean, one of the weaknesses in the academy, in my view, is the lack of historic knowledge on the part of students, not only with respect to architectural history in general, but to the history of their own place in particular. And therefore, as designers, I think we have collectively erased, effectively, the traces of our own cultures, because we've turned this into a kind of generic technological exercise of pushing shapes around and everything like that. You lose something in that exercise. Architecture, not as a profession, but architecture as a practice, is really, in my view, rooted in kind of remembering that as a human race, we are rooted in people who came before us and who will come after us. And in the sense that it's not just about the present, but really about the continuity of what it is. I mean, without that sense, I don't think there would be a Central Park. There wouldn't be the Chicago plan that I played in as a child. There wouldn't be that water. I mean, those moves are made with an idea that there's something that comes after you. And I think without a historic sense in the profession, you can't actually develop as a professional, because you're cut off from the root of human experience. And history is one of those things. And so I can't, you know, I stick my finger. Practice and theory and history are an integral part of teaching design. A designer who is cut off from the root of history, from the root of theory, you know, it cannot advance as a designer. And whether you talk to Safdie or you talk to Rem or you talk to any of these practitioners, every one of them, whether they publicly admit it or not, because I'm next to them, the private conversation of the sorcerer shrink, with the shrink with the sorcerer, the reason that it's private is because a lot of these private conversations are about those things that are not specifically publicly admitted as the basis for what it is. There's the mythology of what designers do, and that is the sorcery part of it. But there's the factual part of what the considerations really are, and that's a very private pursuit, which is not often shared in the in a public domain. And so you have to understand, we live as in the academic world with a weight of mythology that is fed into our system, which has to be debunked, right? And I will tell you, good designers are good business people. They're bad managers, but most of them who run successful practices have an incredible commercial sense for what is viable and what is not. And anyone who tells you they don't is lying to you. Because I work with people who claim publicly they're flaky, they don't know anything, blah, blah, blah. It's bullshit. Right? Successful practitioners are realists. They know the world. They know what makes it tick. And other practitioners who work in these traditions, whether it's Foster or anyone, have a sense of history. Foster's firm, for instance, as a Safdie's, have a root that goes way back. I mean, intellectually and emotionally, these two practices, for instance, have roots very far back in history. So at Safdie's, I didn't actually learn too much about management because I'd already kind of picked that up. But there was this other element of what the dialogue was about, which actually, on occasion, Moshe and I still talk about, which is what is not what you're doing, what's the significance of what you do? What's the is it a historic context? I mean, what does it mean? So at some level, when you reach the pinnacle of practice, it's not what it is. That's not where it's at anymore. It's like rich people. You know, talking to a billionaire about money is nonsense. They have so much money, it's not about money anymore, right? And so when you've done so much work and you've done it at a very significant level, it ain't about what it is, it's about what it means. And that's the nature of dialogue that happens at that level. Okay, so now at the end of my time with Safdie, I kind of was at a point where I didn't know what I would do with my life anymore, because I'd kind of like run through all the different kind of permutations of practice. And so at some point, I really decided I would try to go and be a consultant. But first, I had to have my own head shrunk. So I spent 6 months with a coach who shrunk my head first about what I was going to do going forward. I was about 42, so it coincided nicely with a midlife crisis. You know, my resume said, well, you should be president of a big corporate practice, blah, 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 blah. And I went, no, not me. So I spent 6 months arguing with my business therapist about what I should do. And finally convinced her that, no, indeed, I should do this consulting bit. So fortunately, two things happened. One is I found two colleagues, one of whom I'd worked with. I was actually her boss in Tribble Harrisley, Nancy Egan, who was the marketing director, and Marjan Pearson, who was the woman who recruited me to Safdie's job. So these two people were implicated in my past. But then we found that maybe by putting our three intellects together, we could come up and explain a body of knowledge about practice that would have interest for people wanting management consultancy. So Marjan was an executive recruiter, Nancy was a marketing director, and I was a kind of management guy who was more with finance, project management, you know, the kind of the guts of running the propeller. And I owe them a great debt, because the three of us, even though we weren't in the same business together, for 10 years shared information and actually developed a body of knowledge together, which then each of us benefited from. And that's the other kind of lesson, which is of today, which is, you know, if you can't make it, nobody can make it alone. And I know a lot of people who try to do that, but even if you're out on your own, I think you need to understand how to match your intellect with other intellects, and then the combination, the amalgam of those things is greater than each of you individually. The other thing that happened was I was appointed to the Harvard faculty, which was another, I would like to say, I did it on purpose, but it was another kind of random event because my professor from my first year at JSD happened to be Jorge Silvetti, who was then chairman of the department, and one day called me up and said he needed me to repay a favor, and I said to him I didn't know I owed you anything, but since he had been my professor 20 years previously, I said yes, and so I started teaching practice at GSD. But that transition meant that I had to take the things that I did and explain them in ways that would be transparent to others. That is what a consultant is. You can be an actor, but don't have to explain it in a way that's transparent to others. When you're a teacher and you're a consultant, you have to take the knowledge that's in your head or your experience, and you have to convert it into something that is transparent to others that they can actually understand. So this process started me thinking about all the things that I had learned in practice and had to convert what it was into something like these diagrams where you can talk to people who've never been there, never seen it, never done it, you know, make it transparent what the real issues are. In 1996, Rem Koolhaas was also appointed to the faculty of Harvard. There was a short discussion after his inaugural address at the GSD with regard to his joining the faculty. It was a two-second hallway meeting. I introduced myself. He asked me whether I spend time in London. I said no, but I could. And the rest was history, because basically in two conversations, it was established that Oma was broke and he was at a loss to know what to do, but thought he had a lot of potential in the publishing of small, medium, large, extra large. And my statement to him was, I was interested in managing firms. And he said, well, that's interesting, because I need someone to look at it. And it started a very productive collaboration that started in 1996 and ended more or less in 2001 when 9/11 happened. So that really was an issue of then coevolution, where I came out of that lesson different than when I went in. OMA came out different too, but I mean, it changed me as much as what I did for them, I think, changed them. And so this was one of those defining moments as an adult where, you know, you're out of your gestation period, but you get a second chance to live a life that you didn't think you were going to live. And the OMA thing, actually, I'll explain in these diagrams later what it actually did in specific terms. And after OMA, having come out of it, I no longer could look at practice through the eyes of management. It became clear to me that that was a completely non-productive way of looking at practice. No one goes into practice to be a business person. If you go into business, you go into business, right? You find something that's profitable to do. And design can be profitable, but you know, the scalability of that profit is not something that you would do as a commercial enterprise. So, and my interest had waned anyway in that. So at that point, I abandoned my interest in management and looked again to practice as a way of integrating how people thought about what they wanted to be integral to how it is that they conducted themselves commercially. So it's really led by practice, and you look at organizational management and finance as a consequence of that. You try to integrate those things. And I, by teaching at SciArc was another issue, which is at some point I had actually gotten upset with Harvard because over the years I'd continued to teach practice as a classroom exercise. And I'm the other thing that I would feed into the academy is that practice is best taught in studio. It's like trying to teach surgical techniques in a classroom. The best surgical technique is learned in the operating room. And the best kind of practice agenda is learned in the studio environment. And the reason is that you can integrate all of the considerations of how you operate as a designer at a very high level within an integrated environment where the issues of practice are actually brought to life because you have to deal with them within the context of actually having to design something. I think the problem that a lot of students have going out into the world is that it's been so denatured as a process that it's kind of, you get the denatured version of what it is to be an architect or a designer. It's actually taking out too many impurities, and so you don't get the full spectrum of benefit from taking vitamins, for instance. You know, it's like people who take herbs, and I'm sure a lot of you kind of take herbs and stuff for your health. But you know, if you just single out the spectrum and you just get the very narrow spectrum, you might think it's good for you, but actually you're missing out on most of the benefit of it. So it's the same thing with design. If you present things in their purest form, you can't actually practice anything that is in that pure form. It doesn't matter whether it's architecture or law or anything like that. It doesn't work. So I think that there are a lot of purists running around that think, well, for intellectual reasons, you can kind of purify the discussion down to it. And that's fine for the academy, for part of the academy. But if you're going to produce people who are active in the world and who have a place in the world, you can't do that. You have to confront the messiness of the world now. You can't wait till later. So here's what this kind of transition produced. Again, I think it's pretty simple. There are four elements that everyone has to deal with. You have to deal with your context. We are all context happy, right? That's the architectural word. But context is, what do you think is relevant about your world that actually it allows you to practice? Then there's identity. It's like, who are you? What do you believe deep in your heart? Then there's work, right? What do you do? And then there's the platform. It's like, if you've got work, what are the resources and organization necessary to do work? When you do work that is consonant with your values, and you have the right resources and organization to do work, what's that? It's the sweet spot, right? You don't have that many problems. So that overlap where the eye is the sweet spot of practice. It is so dumb, but that's the way it is, right? I mean, you are who you are. You believe certain things. You got the work that's consonant with your beliefs, and you have the resources at your disposal and organization to do it. Sounds good to me. Except, if you look into your context and the context isn't supportive of what you of that sweet spot, then you don't have any business. So the essential objective of practice is to ascertain the sweet spot and to look into the context as well. And there's two operations that are happening. You're trying to determine what the sweet spot is in the outside world, and you're interested in how the world looks and discovers your sweet spot, because it's a two-way conversation. It's like, how do I discover you, and how do you discover me, right? And so there are projects, there are clients, there are markets out there, but in a context that looks more like that, right? That's the context of practice is messy. This is the sanitized version of it. And then, you know, the reality is clients aren't really clients, and projects don't really have money, and markets go away, and all that stuff. And your exchange rates are up and down. You know, you have evil politicians. I mean, all these things get in the way of this kind of neatness. So I understand that that's the way it is, but you have to actually think about it that way. You imagine it this way and deal with it that way, okay? But if you want to know the shrink part of it, this diagram is the same diagram I show the most famous architects and landscapers. It's the same diagram. This is what we talk about. So I just want to demystify what it is that we're doing here, is that we're talking about, so what do you believe? How do you work? You know, and most of them say, well, my platform is messed up. It's like, I know what I think I know who I am. Actually, most of the time they don't. The work that they want sometimes is right or not right for who they are. And so a lot of this is discovery. The reason that it's a private conversation is, you know, it's not nice in the world today to kind of reveal that you really don't know what your identity is, right? Or that your platform's faulty, because that tends to scare clients away. Or that you don't know what your relevant context is. Are we good for time? Okay. So, work. Now, in the good old days, it was that people got stuff, they designed it, and then the delivery part was, you know, some people did it and some people didn't do it. But design today in this model, and the PM thing is the project manager, where the project manager sits, is ensures that design is managed properly and is delivered. But today, that's a commodity. Like, it's an environment of assertions of who does it better. Like, I design and I'm a better designer than you are. It's like, prove it. Or, you know, so this kind of design delivery environment is a war of assertions that is not very helpful. So architects beat each other up in the marketplace, claiming, you know, kind of bigger, better, improved design, improved delivery. An enormous amount of education is spent trying to perfect delivery models, which is only a methodology of cutting cost in the profession rather than trying to improve it. So it's not that it's a disavowed model, it's just that's where most of the profession is, but it's definitely a commodity. With the rise of specialization, domain expertise, which means specialized knowledge, like knowledge of hospitals, knowledge of typologies, became the differentiating aspect of practice. And so design delivery became generic, and it was this that was the differentiator in practice. So it's like, I design delivery, like, great, do you know hospitals? So I mean, you know, it's and actually the contribution of OMA to the profession was redefining what domain knowledge really meant and turned it into content rather than domain knowledge. Domain knowledge these are the areas of specialization that really were mapped into typologies and client types. And the innovation that OMA made, in my opinion, being humbly implicated in this exercise, but is that I think REM's major contribution to the profession will be that it's redefining this element of content that allowed the design delivery content model to actually work in a way that was not specifically geared toward a marketplace, but geared toward propelling the profession forward through the generation of content internally to the profession rather than have it externally defined and then for us to sign on board to a marketplace. Okay. So I think that was a real breakthrough. Now, in its wake, something else happened that I think happened rather recently, which takes us out of the domain of this kind of domain knowledge or content into another model, which is where the architect actually sits in the role of strategist, not design strategy, the strategist for the enterprise in which they are the designer. And this is the domain of Burnham. It's the domain of Olmsted. It is the domain of people who are the activists within the profession that define the strategy for the client. It's not being defined for the architect. It is where the architect themselves exercises their knowledge of environment and goes either in the public domain or to clients with money, and where they are entrusted with the spatial strategy that will define both the content design and implementation that follows from that strategy. It is a departure from the narrow vision of architectural education that we have had for the last 50 years. And it means that we are not simply training designers. We are training people who are active participants in redefining the society in which we live. We're defining the spatial qualities and spatial investments in the cities which are being built. And that is the place to which this profession needs to address itself, because that is the differentiation by value, not by service and not by expertise, but it is the differentiation of our profession by adding value to the society and not simply being a participant as a service provider. And so in this model, you know, the actual control of projects means that there's an escalating view of how you control it, and the control point then went from here to here to here, and I just take one role within the realm of architectural practice, which is the project manager, and you know, all different firms call project managers the same thing, but in fact the role in which they play is vastly different depending on which model of practice that you're in. And many of my clients have started here, then went to here, and now are here in a space of 10 years. In the last 10 years, many of my clients have actually moved just from that to this. And what it means is that when you are looking at your own definition as a player within it, you can look, there's room for everybody, right? You can be interested just in content, you can be interested just in design, you can be interested just in implementation, or you can be interested just in strategy. That's fine. Everyone can do that. But the value is in the system of connecting all those domains. And the figures around the last revolution in life on this planet after the Industrial Revolution were those that sat in the middle of that quadrangle. That was Olmsted, that was, you know, that was these professionals that didn't define themselves as designers or as this or that. I mean, they understood the integrative nature of that mission and were actual players in their societies. You couldn't have done Central Park in the top two models. Wouldn't have worked. You had to be in this model. And so there's room in this profession at this moment for these people again. And some of the top practitioners have embraced that opportunity and are pursuing it. And I think that at the end of this recession, the need for that those people will be even greater than before the recession, because what is happening is that the institutional spending channels, with the collapse of the credit markets and the nationalization of a lot of the banks and everything like that, again, it will be quasi-governmental investments that will be being made because it's been taken out of private hands. And the people who do that will define the use of money in spatial investing. But, I mean, the thing that the profession has actually never been able to come to grips with is the uneasy relationship with money. It's that money's over there and we're over here, right? So it's always been this binary condition of opposition between the interests of design as the bearers of truth and beauty, And then the people with the money who were the, you know, kind of dirty money grubbers and, you know, kind of the devil that we had to kind of defeat. But I'm telling you that that binary relationship is flawed in conception. In actuality, what we need to do is subsume the mission of investment and actually define what that investment is. And why would that be our mission? Is because in the future, the issues of environment, the issue of human rights, the issues of you know, societal breakdown in terms of the ability of governments to actually service populations will require us as thinkers about space, not just, you know, picking glow-in-the-dark pink bathroom tile, but, you know, larger scope, to actually define for governments, for corporations, for municipalities, how spatial configurations, investment, and programming will actually work. And nobody can do it. A banker can't do it, a lawyer can't do it, a politician can't do it. The only people who can do it are the people who are trained spatially to deal with these problems. And so your education, even though right now you may be, you know, all excited about certain things, over the course of your career, it's an acquisition of a repertory that would allow you, potentially, to encompass these other domains. And so I'm not suggesting to you that everyone should run out of here screaming that, you know, eureka, we're going to, you know, redo the curriculum of the school or anything like that. All I'm saying is that the acquisition of that repertory is an important thing for people who want to be real players at the table and not continue this kind of antagonism with the resources that society needs to deploy. We actually have to help them do that. This is just an amusing sideline of the Kohlhaas variations. When I explained these diagrams to Rem, he took the blade and he drew that. He says, why couldn't it be this way? So the propeller, he kind of like, so this is the kind of, you know, you draw one diagram and, you know, he countered with that diagram and then Amo kind of wound up being that. But if you really look at how Oma and Amo kind of fit into this pyramid, it really was that OMA at its inception, you know, kind of existed like this. And then Amo actually existed as this. So, in fact, the reason that they were born separately, but then they needed to be rejoined, is because, in fact, the rejoining of all four of those domains required them to be kind of reintegrated. So they were born, the Amo was born separate as a way of antagonizing the old model. I mean, which is a classic REM thing to do, right? It's like, take the model, find something to antagonize the existing status quo, and then when that debate is kind of like resolved, then you can kind of like re-engage them, so. and then this is like where we've been, right? So in the 1950s, at the end of World War II, as opposed to 1850 or after the Industrial Revolution, the skills and craft part of practice was non-globalized, and the basis of architectural education and practice was based on skills and craft. In the 70s, the idea of specialization came into play. It created it created a new profession, which was marketing professional services. Up till 1960, marketing professional services didn't exist, really. It was only in the 70s with specialization that people actually started having to market architectural services, and it was because of this the specialization that happened, which allowed actually firms to even articulate why they would market. But then the control of larger practices moved from the people who were brought up in this era of skills and craft, and the control of firms kind of went to the people who were specialists, and then what happened? The craft and skills of those firms devolved. They actually went backwards because they were not valued. and the people who were good who were good with their craft and skill knowledge were actually devalued in terms of compensation and appreciation within those firms. So actually, practice went took a step backward in the 70s and 80s because the integrity of the discipline, this core is the discipline of design, the discipline of architecture, is this kind of nucleus of what it is. But with the specialization thing, it was a marketing thing where that took over in terms of what it was, and then this kind of shriveled. And now we're into the strategy bubble where that where the control of firms will pass to strategists. Again, if you really look at the restructured offer of firms that are design firms, it is that the craft core, the discipline of architecture, there is a core to the discipline, and that includes design and spatial thinking. That cannot go away. If that goes away, we lose our value completely. We have no value. It's because that is the value that differentiates us from bankers, lawyers, politicians, and everything else. So the discipline of architecture remains an important part of the educational mission. But it's the strategy which is the differentiator now between being a vendor and being a player, right? So if you look at someone like Vignoli or others who grew up in the craft tradition, skipped the specialization ring and actually have gone to looking at the discipline and strategy. And that is the positioning of high design practices now, like OMA, which is why we can you can go out into the marketplace and design, the master plan for Ras Al Khaimah. Architects generally did not with regularity go out and capture whole cities to design. But the only thing that allows you to do that is that you're a strategist, which means that someone trusts you with spatial deployment, right? Because you're actually, in designing a city, you're just not designing places to live. It's designing a workspace. You're designing a business platform. You're designing a logistical platform as well. So if without that knowledge, why would anyone hire you? So if you're not a strategist, you can't do that. But if you don't have the discipline of design, you can't do it either, because you don't know what to you don't know how actually the form of the spatial deployment will actually work. So this is the key to the revised value that practices are putting out into the marketplace. Okay. All right, I'll skip that. So in closing, there are these things that I mentioned before: sustainability, human rights, that are the ingredients or some of the ingredients of the next phase of practice, which the life on the planet, the way in which we live and take ourselves into the future depends highly upon the spatial deployment and quality of that deployment, and the only people who can actually do it are us. So I look at all of the young faces in this audience with hope and with encouragement that even though the near to midterm looks kind of rotten, the longer term is that you guys have a lot to do. There will be very productive things that you can do with your life, and that my encouragement to you is in practice to think about what it is that you're doing now and to have high ambitions for yourself with regard to your participation in society and not simply with regard to the smaller things that you can do now, but you need to acquire this over time, and it requires patience. So my end is that you must love what you do, that even in the time when it sucks, it has to be worth it. And right now it sucks, but it's got to be worth it, and so stick with it. And that's my admonition to all of you. So.